Welcome to Shadows of the Veil 14, Memory and Dream. Before we get started, if we can get some quick introductions. First up is Dan.
I'm Dan. I'm playing Arlo Stonefist, a monk whose monastery was attacked by the nobles, or agents of them anyway. He's very much interested in seeing their downfall.
Yes. Next up is Jack.
I'm playing Georgina Mivian, a self-styled scholar who has long been caring for a child that she just found out was a little person.
Yes.
So that's news. Oh, and she also has an ancient witchwood sword that used to belong to the same race. It's very confusing.
Yes. Next up is Jeff.
I'm Jeff. I'm playing Sophia Correale. She is a former Templar of the Church of the Highborn. Overseeing the nobles' corruption spreading into the church, she decided to leave and find a way to root out that corruption, and is also known as the Bloody Angel of Tuscombe.
Yes. Last but not least, we've got Will, our guest.
I'm playing as Asperum, a golem that probably has the shortest record for being a shadow, and is now out here with the rest of the group, just trying to stay alive.
Yes. Alright, so let me get our obligation, duty, morality going.
I'm going to say that 100 sails straight over, as does the 66. I haven't even looked yet, but...
Yeah,
probably. Yeah.
I think the 41 might be to Trina, though.
The 41 is... Yes, it's to Trina.
Okay, cool. So, before we go into this mission, let's do a little recap of last week's, if someone can volunteer to give a little rundown about what happened last week and the significant events.
Well, the group, after escaping Tuscombe, when it was attacked by the King's forces, were drawn through Mav into a forest of witchwood trees that surrounded what we believe or know to be the Queen's Spire.
Mm-hmm. Blocks it off, pretty much, yeah.
Okay, and so as we enter the forest, we quickly lose both Mav and Yoko.
And Darlo for a short time.
Yeah. Well, we lose each other when we get into it, but originally we lose the Fade Fox, Yoko, and Mav. And as we try to puzzle out, we found out eventually that the forest, well, not the forest itself, but tricks were being played on us, getting us separated and lost. And eventually we found, and Trina, while trying to puzzle out what was going on, had a vision of Mav burning. And so she had a drive to go find him. And this led to the group eventually happening upon, or rather, the group was. Were we attacked by them first? I'm forgetting how we encounter them, but eventually we encounter three of the little folk.
You were able to see them, and so they attacked.
Oh yeah, because she. Oh, and also Trina, in her drive to find Mav, ingested the sap of the witchwood, which helped her dispel the illusions. Mm-hmm. And after we encountered the little folk, Trina tried to get past them to save Mav, since she knew that they were blocking their way, but they ended up fighting, and during the fight, they began to burn Mav because Trina was trying to get past them, and eventually we are able to subdue the little folk, but once we get to Mav, who is already on fire, and surrounded by the little folk who seem to be... celebrating? They were kind of like in the midst of a chant.
Mm-hmm. And also he was on fire with veil fire, so green fire was burning him.
And as the fire burns him, he cried out, and soon it's revealed to be that Mav kind of turns into, or rather turns back into, the little folk's prince.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And yes. That's about all we know.
And so, one other detail, and I hope you guys saw the crawl, but Mav, when you thought he was a little child, he is a known Dreamwalker. So someone who is able to pass freely through the veil, which is a very powerful ability. And another thing special about that is he is able to see when people are possessed. That is something that... as far as you all know, no one else can do except for Dreamwalkers, and so he is able to do that. But on the flip side, he is also vulnerable to possession. And so, yeah, lots of crazy things happened back in episode 3, which was Dreamwalker. But now we're up to episode 14, Memory and Dream, and we'll get right into it. So, here we go. So you can see the little folk, many more than you had subdued. And so they are bowing to the prince. They are calling out, "The Prince of Haven has returned. The Prince of Haven has returned." And one of them steps forward, this guy that got really beaten up, but just says, Prince, do you remember?" And you can see the being formerly known as Mav, he is crying, and he nods, and he says, "Yes, I remember. I remember everything." And he covers his face, wipes away the tears, and the other little folk are looking at the rest of you and just says, "And what of them?" And the prince holds out his hand and he says, "These folk helped me here. They are pardoned of the great taboo. They will not be touched. They cannot be touched. I decree this." And you can hear a murmur of discontent rippling through all of the little folk, but no one actually says something to countermand this order. At the same time, he turns to Dreamwalker and walks up to you, and you see him reach out for your hands. What do you do?
If you're speaking, Jack, you're muted.
Good, because I just grunted a bit as I was thinking. What sort of look is in his eyes? Is it mainly friend? Like, basically, she's trying to see kind of if the Mav she knew is in there in any way.
Yeah, you see that he clearly recognizes you.
All right, yeah, she reach out and...
The mannerisms are the same. The facial tics, the way that he reaches out with his hands, it's all the same.
All right, she'll take his hands, but, you know, tears are running down her face. She's, if nothing else, she can't console herself with the fact that even if it was just to turn him back into what he was, it seemed like he still suffered.
Right. And he looks up at you, and he, the words that he says next, you can actually hear some shouts of anger from the little folk, because he says, "You are still family."
Oh, she would get down and hug him.
Okay, so yes, some of the little folk are like, "Rawr, rawr," but this dude over here just waves his hand and tells him, silence, our prince is back." But you can hear others going, but Duke, this cannot be." And so yes, there's just lots of things going on right now. At the same time, you can hear someone shout out, "But one of the foul ones has our sword! Look!" And they're pointing at Veilrender. And this is just causing all kinds of, like, just grr. Before the prince says anything, what do you say? Oh, you know, actually, before this happens, he actually says, he asks you, why did you name me Mav?
Dreamwalker leans back and wipes some of the tears from her face, and she says, "Mav was the name of my brother, or the brother I would have had if my mother hadn't taken ill in childbirth and miscarried."
And so he says to you, "Fate surely brought us together, for my true name is Mavellion, Prince of Haven." As little folk are shouting about Veil Render, before Mavellion says anything, what do you all as a group say, if you say anything? Optional. You don't have to.
Arlo's not going to necessarily say anything, but he's going to kind of defensively kind of interpose himself. Kind of like, I don't want to like block your token, but he's going to kind of make sure he's, you know, not making sure people don't get, you know, the little folk don't get too close to Trina, like not close enough to attack or anything like that if they look like they're about to.
Right. So, yeah. What do you want to say about this with Veil Render and,
Trina would be too focused on Mav or Mavellion to really say anything in response. However, I am point of order because I just can't remember. After we used Veil Render to banish the Prince of the Fallen, is one of the runes on it still glowing?
No. But I mean, it was glowing after that happened, but it still has that power. So.
Okay.
I was just reacting to him, I think.
Well, I was just wondering if it caused one of the runes to permaglow or if that was just for the moment. Okay. But yeah, she'd be too invested in the prince to really... She probably wouldn't even hear them.
Oh, okay. Sure. Anyone else want to say anything in this whole situation? And actually, let's get some RP here, too, because this is something far beyond discovering trolls or being the Tuscombe, because at least with trolls, everyone knew... Trolls exist. Everyone knew trolls were in the Vale. The tales of the little folk were pure legend. So this is just something out of your wildest dreams that there is actually a whole race of beings, that the little folk are real, and that all that stuff about witchwood trees and they being the wardens of the trees back when the trees were all burned from the Vale. I mean, this is... you're looking at living legends right now.
Jatrina would have questions, but they'd be more focused on the prince, mainly on how did you end up kind of turning into a human child? Why were you in the Veil? Mm-hmm. All, stuff along those lines. Like, she would definitely, if she wasn't having this personal connection, she would be very interested, but unfortunately, she has it, so.
Right.
In Arlo's case, he kind of, you know, being not so much an outcast, but not like a member of day-to-day society for the most part. Mm-hmm. I'd say their status as legends and myths are probably a little bit more tenuous to him. You know, like maybe, and I feel like he wouldn't be so much surprised, if only because of his general demeanor. But he's certainly he wasn't expecting it, that's for sure. But he's not kind of like in shock or anything. He's just kind of, it's like, okay, you know, this is how the world works, you know. We're out here, I've never been here, I had no way of knowing.
Right. Okay. Sophia?
So, sorry, I've been having some network connectivity issues. Oh, okay, reacting a little bit. So Sophia is incredibly surprised. She had read, like, she had heard, like, rumors or, not even rumors, just like myths and legends from her time in the Church of the Highborn.
And not only that, one key detail is that everything that is actually in the doctrine was either they never existed, or if they did exist, they were creatures of incredible evil. And witchwood trees are evil. Little folk are evil. Trolls are evil. So it's just evil, 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 evil. Of course, you have a different perspective.
I'm sensing a pattern.
Discovered. Yeah, exactly.
Yes. This is definitely, like, based on Sophia's newer experiences, she can tell that the religious doctrine is probably heavily biased towards people.
Yep.
And biased against everyone else. And so she's really kind of shocked that Mav turned out to be their prince. that there are actual little folk. And she isn't, like, standing there jaw on the floor, but she would probably be fairly awestruck until she sees Yoko, and then she would, like, probably go try to, pick him up or maybe gently scold him for running away and leaving her all alone in this creepy-ass forest.
Right. Okay. Also, another detail is that a lot of the little folk are glaring at a sparum. They really don't like, I mean, you can tell they do not like golems. That is just like whispers of unliving thing, worst of the foul ones.
Yeah, and Sparum's trying to just, is just kind of quiet, being quiet at the moment, probably trying to not necessarily bring attention to himself, but just is kind of, as his default behavior is observing, kind of just.
Right. And one thing you notice too is when they say foul ones, they're talking about trolls, humans, and golems. They don't even distinguish. Like, everything is either them or not them. And you can see the axis their world turns around. So just
bunch of tiny racists.
Yeah, well, I mean, from the little history in which witch trees were burned in the Vale, and they were all pushed out. So,
oh, I never said they weren't racists without reason to be.
Right.
But a bunch of little racists.
So at this point, there's just general consternation over all this is happening. And Mavellian turns to the Duke and says, but what of my mother? But what of my mother? And the Duke just shakes his head and he says, she passed of her illness. She has joined your father in the beyond. And at that, Mavellian starts crying again. So, there are more people yelling about Veil Render, though. And so finally, Mavellian wipes away more tears. He's crying a lot. And just says, no, no, no. That sword, Veil Render, is hers. And there's screams, never, never. That was your entire mission. That sword is yours. How could she, a foul one, wield a witchwood sword? And so at this point, Mavellian just says, what is the first rule of our weapons? What is the first rule? And you can hear, well, it's a lot of silence, actually. People are not very pleased with him. And finally, the Duke speaks up and lifts his witchwood sword, and you see a matching rune on it that is very familiar to the one that from Valrender. And the Duke, even though he's gritting his teeth, he does follow what his prince says, and he says, the sword chooses the wielder. And Tatrina, what do you do? Like, you've got Veil Render. Someone shouts, prove it! Prove it!
Sword chooses the wielder. The best idea I can come up with, given how it keeps reacting to violence, I take out Veil Render and nick my thumb on it to draw blood and let the blood soak the blade.
Okay. Wow, that's pretty cool. Yeah. The runes all light up just like in a pulsing sequence along the blades, and there's a gasp of surprise and people are like, what? How can this be? But she is not of the chosen. How can this be? So it's like you are destroying centuries of tradition by this, but it is proof. Veil Render responds to you and your blood. And
I'll actually raise the glowing sword up and kind of hypothesize slash pontificate and say, it is because of this sword that we have managed to come this far. And bring your prince, and she'll say that a bit meekly as she looks to Avelion. In the end, the sword still serves the Chosen, but it has chosen, well, I guess it's a bit redundant. It has chosen another to be its wielder.
Mm-hmm. Yep. And then someone else shouts, "But does she even know how to wield one? Only the Chosen can do so."
Hey, I've done cool stuff with it, just not fight with it.
And so they're like, "Bah!" And this one over here says, "Her form is sloppy and terrible. It's horrible." And actually, Mavellion lifts his hand and says, "Silence! Vale Render has chosen her. I will teach her how to wield it." And at that, others are like, "Oh, what? What?" So, you have unlocked the ability to choose an ancient sword form, i.e. lightsaber form. And I believe the one that works off of intellect is Cerezo? I don't remember.
Yeah, I don't have the thing in front of me either. Intellect Cerezo, but she also has points in cunning, which would get her actually Sheehan, which is actually in her career.
Well, actually, they use Cerezo.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
I'll pull up the talent tree because Ogdudes isn't agreeing with me right now.
But yeah, so you have access to that. So with some XP, you will be able to use Veil Render as it was meant to be used. And
that means you can put points in the skill now?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Nice.
So at this point, the Duke says, "There's nothing more to be done here. We must go back to Haven." And one little note there. Remember, your base was called Shadowhaven. And their home is known as Haven. And this Mavellion says, "There is danger. We are in grave, grave danger. The people of the Vale are pushing north. Everything that was in my dream before I left the forest, everything is coming true. We must find the four keys, all four, and we must get to the Bloodspire." And at that, the Duke says, "Yes, yes, we will discuss this more back at Haven." And so, with a lot of grumbling from some of the little folk, they do lead you deeper into the forest. And you see a city. And as you are getting close to it, you don't see it until you're right there. Everything just blends into the backdrop of the Witchwood trees until you are literally right there in front of it. So there are shocked cries from all around as other little folk that weren't a part of that gathering see you all there. And they're just completely flabbergasted. Like, what? What? What is the meaning of this? So... The Duke turns to Mavellion and just says, "So, what did you discover?" And Mavellion turns to you all and says, "There's much to explain, but ever since I was a child, I have dreamed, and you know me as a dreamwalker, and our world is in grave peril. There are four keys that can open the Bloodspire. One of them you carry," and he turns to Trina, and he's looking right at Veil Render. "Another is from the tallest of," and he almost says "foul ones," and then he corrects himself and says, trolls. And at that, you see Creaking Oak. It's like he already knows, and the gift of the Tusk Mother, that tusk, is another key. And he turns to Shard and says, "You are the third, but the fourth I do not know." And Shard's like, "What? What? What are you talking about?" So once again, this is like, he's an unliving construct. What? How can he be a key to the ancient Bloodspire? This doesn't make any sense. but
I know Arlo doesn't really know much about these keys other than that they are apparently these unconnected things, at least to his eyes. Would he be able to potentially seek for the last one?
Hold that thought.
Okay.
I'll say yes, but yeah, hold that thought.
Gotcha.
Actually, yeah, go ahead and do the seek. That's fine. That's fine.
I mean, there are three of them right here.
Okay, so he feels, he reaches out with his senses, you know, with his feelings, and just gonna look at the seek power. I haven't used it that much, so.
So, I will say this. Who among you has a symbol of the Sky Queen?
Would all those prayer beads count?
Sure.
Sophia probably would. Probably on her sword.
Yeah. Let's go with that. So the Seek goes...
So yeah, Arlo's going to use those dark side points, or one of them at least.
Okay.
Use them both, why not?
Yeah, the Seek goes right over to Durandal. Specifically the symbol of the Sky Queen on it.
So he'll turn to Sophia and say, that sword you carry, it feels similar to the rest of these keys that he talks of.
Mavellion's like, what? We have all four keys? So he's really shocked, and he runs over to look at Durandal, and he says, yes, yes, how was I not able to guess at this? But he says,
very strange. It's an old sword. I mean, it's been in my family for generations, but I had no idea it had this much significance.
Oh, and Dotrina had a very good point. Dotrina, if you can talk about that out loud.
After Durandal has pointed out to me the fourth key, she muses a bit aloud. My sword, an object of reference for the little folk, an object of reference for the trolls, a golem, and an object of reverence for humans. It seems like each of the keys has found a very important spot in each of the races.
Mm-hmm. And also, one thing, as you're saying this, tell you what, why don't you just do, and I'll make this a hard lore check.
Lore. Keep forgetting if I put ranks in that or not. I'm gonna upgrade.
I'll upgrade back. Oh, never mind.
Oops, sorry. Too fast.
Okay. Don't worry about that. We'll take it as strain, but we'll get to straining your wounds in a little bit. So, as you're musing on this, you look at the symbol of the Sky Queen on the sword, and it's not like you haven't noticed this before, but with this new information, this seems a lot more significant to you. The symbol of the Sky Queen is a star, is a four-pointed star surrounded by a circle. So
now that is very intriguing, and Katrina will just vocally point to each corner of the star and list a race. Humans, trolls, golems, little folk. Mm-hmm. And then just trace, and then just with an almost idly trace the circle with her finger.
So at this, some of the little folk are like, bah! No! Blasphemy! That symbol was ours first! For the four clans! Ah! So, yeah, I mean, the fact that you guys are here in Haven is just really upsetting to so many of the little folk. But the fact that their prince is with you is pretty much the only thing that is kind of keeping them back. And Mavellion does look a little bit worried, but at the same time, he's like, they brought me back. This is, you know, stop it. And at this, the Duke says, can you blame them? Can you blame us? Remember your history. We lived in peace with the Foul Ones. In the Vale, long ago, we were attacked. Our trees were burned. We were pushed out. They tried to kill us all. And Mavellion says, yes, I know this. I've dreamed this. I remember it as if it happened to me. But this is no excuse. They have nothing to do with this. They helped me. They are my friends. They are my family. And
sorry, Sophia would wait for Mavellion to finish, but then if anything, this joining, and she holds her arms out and gestures to Asperum, to the little folk, to Creaking Oak, and then to us, like, this can't possibly just be coincidence that all representatives of all four of these clans are here, gathered here now as friends and allies, and with all four keys to the spire here as well. This too cannot just be coincidence.
And yet our scouts tell us that there is a massive force of Foul Ones that is marching north towards us right now. Are they friends? Are they allies?
They are a force that we ourselves oppose.
And have opposed. And have fought.
Only Foul Ones fight amongst themselves.
It wasn't just us fighting them. We stood shoulder to shoulder, side by side with trolls, to fend them off. We're responsible for saving a majority of Tuscombe from that force. If they march here, we will stand against them just as we have before.
Troll, human, golem, all synonyms for the same word, Foul One.
And yet, we're all connected, so what does that make you?
All connected? Huh. And yeah. But at this point, Mavellion says, we need to prepare. They are already sending scouts our way. That is their way. We cannot let them find Haven. If we must, let them pass. And at this, the Duke says, no, never. We cannot let them pass. We cannot. Any Foul One that steps into the forest that is not a friend of yours will die. If they do not turn back, they will die. And the Duke looks at you all and says, do you agree?
Tertrina will, at that question, she'll turn around after she was kind of losing herself and thinking of the symbol's meaning on Durandal, and she'll say, the army will not simply pass a witchwood forest by. They will feel compelled to burn it. And she'll look around at the trees, the great wonders around her, and say, I do not know if or should we attack the army directly, but we should make sure they do not either see the forest or get a chance to pass through it.
Well, they can already see the forest. I mean, everybody can see it from Tuscombe.
Oh, I know that. Okay.
I mean, it was like a massive forest stretching across the horizon, so.
Well, I didn't know how much we had been, how long it had been since we escaped that we saw the forest. Then she'll change the answer to, there may be a way we can stop the army from finding this, finding you. And she'll gesture around to Haven in general. But I do not think full-scale war will be the way.
A full-scale war would just mean a quick and bloody end to all who live in, to all who reside here. Their force is far too large to take alone.
And Mavellion nods at that and says, we cannot hope to take them on directly. The the people of the Vale, their forces are large. That Vale is fertile ground. They outnumber us scores upon scores, many times over. The best we can hope for is to divert their scouts, have their scouts use our trickery, use our magic, and have them pass through the forest, but away from here. But I do not think that we... Well, actually, he turns to you and says, we may have to shed blood. We can't let them find Haven. We'll let them pass through, but we can't let them find here.
I think shedding blood is to defend your home is fine. Like, there will be fights and there will be bloodshed in diverting them, but Titrina's right. They will not just walk through a Witchwood forest. They will burn every inch of it they can. There has to be another way. You know more of the spire than us. What do you know of it? Is there anything there that can aid us?
It is a place of great power that has been locked away for centuries, but with the four keys that Mavellion dreamed of, you can gain entrance. That is our only hope.
Arlo will speak up briefly and say, could it perhaps serve as an amplifier for the quite potent illusionary magics you've put on display here?
Possibly, but and you all know, I mean, the Queen Spire, and they know it as the Blood Spire, is really far away. So it's not like something that you can access to help out with the situation.
Fair enough.
Yeah. However, at this, the Duke turns to Sophia and nods and says, I agree with this one. There will be bloodshed. And we must be willing to do so. You know, if they burn these trees, you know, we do have forest fires are an act of nature. We are used to that as long as we can keep the flames away from Haven. But we must keep the scouts away from here. So at that, the Duke begins to talk to other little folk, and they are starting to split up into teams. And it looks like, and actually Mavellion would just tell you that the little folk are very, very few in number. And the one thing that is very different about them, though, is that all of them are gifted. So, yeah.
That's
very many.
Astounding.
But all of them are gifted. Some more than others, but all of them are. One thing that, and this is more of just like a minor detail, but don't forget, all of you have plus one FR in here, in the forest. And I'll leave it at that. Don't forget your plus one FR. But yes, so the Duke wants your help with diverting scout teams that will be going through the forest. They will be dealing with the same magic that you all dealt with in terms of getting lost, trying to find their way out. And this time, though, the little folk will be actively trying to divert them just away from Haven, but still through the forest. And because they're hoping that the scouts might be able to just get through, find a way, and then track back and spare the forest. But who knows? But at the same time, if any of them press forward and it looks like they will discover Haven imminently, you need to deal with them. And at this point, there are some little folk that do approach you. Some of them are a little nervous. Others actually look at you in wonder, because in some ways you all are creatures of legend as well. I mean, they've seen trolls, but foul ones that look like you? Nah. So, healing herbs and things like that. So you guys can go ahead and start. You can just wipe everything off your token.
Including crits?
Not crits, but setbacks and things like that, even from poison sap and whatnot, you can let go of.
Yeah, there's been time for that to dissipate, I suppose. Mm-hmm.
So, any questions or concerns before you all head out? You will be part of Mavellion's team to help divert these scouts.
Would any of us, this isn't so much to you, Tommy, but to the group, but are any of us particularly adept at scouting, i.e. perception, And if you are, would you like my spyglass? It will be more useful to you than I.
Trina has one yellow, two green.
Whoop. Shame we don't have leading fox here.
Yeah. I'm at one yellow, one green.
I just have two green.
Okay, so you said yours was two and one, Jack, or Trina?
Yeah, one yellow, two green.
All right, so you temporarily, you can hang on to my spyglass for now.
All right.
It's mechanically, it's macro binoculars.
All right. Oh, man, I know there's a question I want to ask, but I can't think of it.
Little folk history, abilities, powers.
Yeah, I guess I would wonder, I mean, how much do the Witchwood swords interact with your gifts? Is it more of a weapon, or do you use it as a focus?
Oh, that's part of the style. You know, it becomes an extension of your will. Or intellect, if you want to be specific, but yeah. Sharp minds, sharper swords.
At what, like, how will we be able to tell if they've gotten too close to Haven for comfort? Will that just be us seeing the other little folk?
Well, you all, the illusion has been wiped away from you. So you now can see Haven, and as you move away from it, you can still see it. So you're not in that weird, crazy illusion effect anymore. So you'll be able to tell when the scouts are getting close to it or not.
All right.
No, we lost Will.
Yeah, let's give Will some time to get back. So actually, before we move forward, while we're waiting for Will, let's get some RP just in terms of the mission that you have. And yeah.
I guess Tritrina would ask Mavelian, it's like, what is the history of Haven? Is this where you came after you left, after the little folk left the Vale?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Were the Witchwoods already here?
Yes.
I assume the Bloodspire was as well. Was it because of the Witchwood and the Bloodspire that you came here, or was it something else?
Well, this was, we knew that there was a great forest of Witchwood trees that,
Were the trolls already outside the Vale? Like, had they already established Tuscombe by the time you came along, or was Haven basically first?
Haven was first.
Actually, were the trolls, were they in the Vale with the rest of you?
Yes. However, Mavelian says that we have a history before the Vale. It's disputed, but in my dreams, this was our home first.
Hmm.
But the children of Bloodspire, and he looks at the humans, they invaded and pushed us south first. We left long ago and thought that they would never reach us, but then they, known as the Highborn, invaded the Vale.
So you think, or you, in your dreams, the forest and Haven existed before the Bloodspire?
He doesn't know. But you do remember the runes on Veilrender. Veilrender's a very old Witchwood sword, and it said, for every one of us killed by the children of Bloodspire, shed blood of 10 of theirs. So it's like a much older conflict, even before the Vale. So kind of like a little back and forth here. So according to Mavelian, he believes that at least the little folk, they were here first in this place, but they were forced south. They weren't pursued though, but they were forced south. They settled in the Vale with other humans that were not related to the ones from the north. Remember, you have that big schism between the Highborn and the Lowborn. They speak different languages, completely different languages. And the Lowborn humans lived in peace with the little folk and the trolls. And then the Highborn, who had already expelled the little folk from this forest, arrived centuries later and did the same thing.
And so how much?
Oh, go
sorry.
Ahead.
No, you go ahead if you.
Oh no! So it's just that they lost this home, and with nowhere else to go, they tried going back. And after the Highborn had taken over the Vale, and they were surprised to discover that the Witchwood Forest was still here, and empty.
So how do the trolls play into all of this? How did they get associated with the Tainted Ones?
Oh, they warred against us too.
Hmm. And the golems, when did they arise?
Oh, the golems were always... the golems were used to chop down and burn the witchwood trees in the Vale.
But do the little folk know who created the golems, or were they just always there?
Always there. Something unliving, always. They've always been.
Interesting. Because she's recalling her conversation with Mitriel about what he remembers. Mm-hmm. And she's trying to associate it. Because it seems like the golems are still made, but if they've always been...
Who knows? Maybe it's the Bloodspire. The Bloodspire is where the Highborn are from. He doesn't call them that. But now you're kind of matching stories to other stories, and pieces are interlocking. And so you think that this is where the Highborn are from. The Bloodspire, or the Queenspire, as they call it.
I'm going to want to take a look at this Bloodspire when we're done with this.
We're all going
heading there anyway, Mavillion says we have to head there. But first, we need to keep these scouts from finding Haven. We must unlock the Bloodspire, find the power within, and save all of our peoples. Okay, so the little folk are splitting up into teams. You all are a team, and we will advance. Alright, so, you can hear a party of scouts. Before you actually see them, prepare yourselves. What do you do? Are some of you in trees, or some of you behind bushes? What are you guys doing?
Trina would be keeping to the bushes. She doesn't trust herself climbing trees.
Okay.
Sophia has shield and sword already drawn. Probably crouched near a bush and moving somewhat quietly. The red of her armor and the cloak kind of... her trying to blend in with the red of the leaves that are around.
Right.
Arlo will be in a tree that has a good overlooking spot that he can watch from unseen, but ready to pounce if necessary.
Okay.
Sparrow would probably be amongst the trees also with Tatrina or Sophia. Definitely not climbing a tree.
Alright. As you can see, some of the numbers are repeated, but it is two separate groups. Well, same group, but it's on purpose. All right, so you see half a dozen scouts slowly moving through the forest, and actually you can hear their conversation before they get to you. So one of them says, I know it was my dream to become a soldier, but this place creeps me out. We've been walking. Yeah, all the trees look the same. I could have sworn that we've been through the same path hours ago. Another one's like, shut up, you're just paranoid. And someone else just says, I don't know. Why are we so far from home? We're called defenders of the Vale. What are we defending? We're invading. I don't like trolls either, but what was that all about? And you saw what happened in the sky, the Sky Queen. She favored them, not us. And someone else says, stop that blasphemy right now. But another sentry says, no. He's right. You know, I don't know. What are we doing so far from home? I just want to go home. And so they're kind of ambling about, and not the sort of patriotic defenders of the Vale that you thought of, but unfortunately, they are also getting quite close to Haven. What do you guys do?
So, I have kind of an idea. I'm going to look to Mavellian and sort of like gesture him to come closer and ask him if his powers of illusion can distort one's voice.
Yeah.
Because I have a new power I want to try out, and it says it only works in combat situations, but I'm sure flavored, it can work for this. So Sophia wants to use her visage to terrify these sentries and send them running.
Okay. Well, if it does specify combat, then we would need to do that in combat.
Okay. Like, well, it's baleful gaze.
Right.
So.
But I mean, hold on to that thought. I mean, I'll definitely let you use it. But if it specifies combat, then I want to stick to that.
Let me double check the long text for it, because the short text just says when targeted by a combat check and within medium range.
Well, yeah, so, I mean, if it's...
yeah.
But what say the rest of you?
I'd look to Sophia and her powerful physique, and I'd say, what if we gave these sentries another chance to see their god? Or rather, to see the Sky Queen's favor again? There's already doubt after Tuscombe about who the Sky Queen favors. What if they had a personal experience of her dissatisfaction?
I'm all for that.
Then I would whisper to Mavellian that we should try and make Sophia appear. If there are any depictions of the Sky Queen, then like her, or if not, as angelic as possible. And then Sophia can use her coercion, to put a mechanical word in there, to scare the sentries off.
Okay. Sure. So I guess this is a deception check?
I guess at least deception to make her look that way. I was wondering if maybe Sophia's excellent coercion could also come into play.
Okay. Well, let me put it this way. This sounds like two checks. First, a check to make her look like a vision of the Sky Queen, and then a check to exert influence from that.
Yes.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think that was along the lines of what I was thinking.
Is there a misdirect in there? I don't know if anyone of us has it. Or if Mav has it, even.
Yeah.
All right. So, yeah, let's... So first up, let's get Sophia looking like... Describe what you do to make her look like this. Like a vision of
Well, I guess Sophia would be the expert on what the Sky Queen would look like.
Yep. But I think we're more looking to Mav for his gifted powers. If he has those in illusion, if he's able to give sort of the illusion of the Sky Queen.
Well, I mean, he kind of... It's one of these things where the fact that he's there allows you to make the check. But remember, he's a little folk. Even though he was in disguise as a human, he doesn't have all that background. They don't worship the Sky Queen.
No, well, so Sophia would describe, in the best sense, like what the Sky Queen appears to be, but it would be relying on his power.
Yeah, so what I'm saying is that the power just lets you do it. So, I guess... Maybe this, instead of a deception check, would be a lore check to get all the details right.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, so let's do that instead.
Sure. Sophia's lore is just too green.
Well, Trina can help out with it, because she's talking to Mavellian. And, you
know. Yeah, and Sophia's helping as well.
what would be the difficulty of the lore check?
Actually, this will be a choose your own difficulty.
Oh, those are always tempting.
Yeah, so how deep into it do you want to go? And, you know, yeah.
You get a boost from Sophia.
She, you know, she's already had that dose of, she's seen what happens to the faithful if they see something convincing enough. So she'd be tempted to go for, I'd say, daunting.
Okay. I will upgrade that once.
All right. I will also upgrade my check. Ah. I don't have anything that would let me reroll lore, would I? Yeah, no.
Do you have... Does anyone have... Do you have a karma point, or...
Don't think I do. I think I spent them all a long time ago. Perhaps the advantage, Trina can't exactly... It's like she's puzzling through, you know, the church has had several iterations of the Sky Queen, depending on what mood of the day, mood of the era. And so I can't exactly pick one that would be the most alluring, but maybe she feels that an intangible presence of the Sky Queen may still have some impact, even if they don't see her.
Okay, sure thing. So, let me do this. It will... Only because you failed the check, it's actually going to be half as effective. So in other words, their difficulty will just be 2 purple. But as you're describing this, part of the problem is that Mavellion just simply does not have the same frames of reference. Do you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
It's like you're trying to describe what he's trying to form around Sophia, and you can see it clearly in your mind, but in terms of expressing that to him, it's a little bit off. But this is what you're going for, so I'll put it on there. So, a statue of the Sky Queen that you have seen before, and yeah. So, and then I'll say with those 2 advantages, those can be 2 setbacks. So it'll be 2 purples and 2 setbacks for the sentries to resist. And then we'll say that... Oh, what's that?
It's just Dan's comment in the chat after you put the picture up.
Oh. And then... Yeah, so let's do that check first, and then you can do a coercion check on top of that, according to how the sentries interact. So what do? Do you just, like, step out of the woods and say, "Behold, I am the Sky Queen"? I mean, you tell me. What's do you jump down from the trees?
No. Because that's all too human. That's unbefitting of a god.
Yeah. Sophia wasn't really upping them anyway, right?
No, what's befitting of a god is for a god to stand there and happen, and them to happen upon this vision of a god.
Okay.
That's a far better description of a god's station. Like, a god doesn't jump out and appear before mortals, at least not one worth taking seriously.
Right. All right, so... You stand there, and the sentries come across you, and are like, what? And this is going to be their check against that illusion. Okay. So, 2 purples, 2 setbacks.
Wait, we flipped upgrade.
Oh, okay. So, 1 red, 1 purple. There are 2 checks. Are you going to do it for both?
Yes.
All right. Here goes. You know what, though? I'm going to flip 2, then.
I thought you did flip.
Oh, did I?
Yeah, what were those other flips then?
Oh, okay, then. Yeah, if I flip, then here's the roll. So here goes. First one. Whoa! Second one. Whoa! They both failed! Okay, so you tell me, the one with the 3 threats, what happens?
They all fall to their knees and begin weeping in reverence. If that's okay.
Sure.
The other group with the advantages, they don't break down, but they fall to a knee and, like, show proper respect.
They're probably a little more bewildered than absolutely abjecting themselves before them.
The ones with the advantages are like, but the Sky Queen, what are you doing here? This is a forest of witchwoods. The most evil of trees. We burned these in the veil. Why? Why are you here?
Sophia would raise a hand and say, "Be still, my children. This world belongs to all, myself included. There is no evil in nature. There is only evil in people."
But what of your son, the Deep Prince, the one who turned against you, the father of all evil?
He is my son. Evil is born from good. Good is born from evil. Good men stand to fight evil. One cannot
exist
without... You're talking
circles, they're like, yeah, they're getting all googly-eyed, like, what?
One cannot exist without the other. But these trees are not evil, nor are they good. They are merely here.
But we have clear orders from the king who worships you.
You take orders? You would take orders from a king over the wisdom of a goddess.
Then what are we to do?
You are to turn back. Return to your homes. Seek out the truth.
Okay. They're like, you want us to abandon the defenders of the veil?
Are you truly defending the veil? Here, so far from home? Or are you invading? And this is where Sophia is actually going to turn to gaze upon them, and her eyes are glowing in a green flame. Kind of like a la Dark Side, if I'd like to use the Baleful Gaze just to flavor the RP for that.
Sure. So they're going, but the Queen Spire, the holiest of mountains, the king has been pushing us towards that. It is said that it is our ancient home.
This is where Sophia would just sort of bellow, "Silence."
Okay.
Turn your quest. Your quest is misguided. Your king has crafted falsehoods.
Right.
He desires only power for his personal gain. This is not my way. This is not our way.
Okay, so let's do this. You're going to get a coercion check, and it'll be two checks because it'll be against both groups. The first group, that's three threats. I'm going to say that you can get three boosts if you want. The other group, it'll be two setbacks because of their advantages.
Okay. So then what is the difficulty?
It's going to be... what you can see there. I'll upgrade it again. Boop. So it's two reds and a purple. Plus three boosts for the first one or two setbacks for the second.
I'm going to roll for the first group first. I'm going to flip.
Do you have any ranks of intimidating?
Actually, let me see. I might, actually. And I do not. So that's fine. Despair.
I know what to do with that despair.
Okay. So the second group is two. I'm going to flip again. Ah.
Well.
All right, the second group. They refuse. They're like, no. This can't be. And the other group is like, peace out, we're gone. And so they actually leave. They're like, no, we're going. You can do what you want, but we're leaving. And two threats, take those two threats as strain, and then tell me what you do with the triumph, though.
Okay. Yeah. I'll say, if they... you refuse to follow the orders of a mad king over your divine goddess, I will return you to the light from whence you were born, and that's gonna be the signal for the ambush.
Okay. At this, they're still on their knees, but they're like, but if we betray the king, we'll be killed for treason. please have mercy on us. So that's what they say, and then the ambush can start. So,
yep.
Yeah.
Their mercy will be a quick death, not a tortured one.
All right. This is going to be a little bit of conflict, though, just so you guys understand.
Oh, yeah, this will totally be conflict.
Okay. So Sophia. The other group, they're gone. They rush back into the forest, so they're no longer there.
Excellent.
All right, so as an ambush, you guys get 2 boosts to your initiative checks, and they get 2 setbacks.
Okay. This is cool.
Arlo should probably go first, because he can probably terrify all of them. Well, not terrify them, but scare them. I don't actually have terrify.
Wow, that is surprisingly good.
So this would be cool, huh?
Arlo's cool. That's actually going to be a 5.1 instead of a 4.1.
Excellent.
She calculated that violence would probably result.
Well, hey, you can't fool all the people all the time. But at least they're going to be cut down by, you know, a vision of their goddess. Or a vision of their god, so... At least they'll die as soldiers and not as traitors. And, Sophia will say that. And you will pass into the light as my children and not as traitors to a mad king.
Ugh, terrible. They just want to go home.
Well, they should have gone home. They're the ones that are sticking around.
They are perfectly free to cut and run after Arlo probably pounds one of them into the ground.
That's true.
Oh, yeah. Right,
so first
with great justice.
First up.
I think one of us...
Yeah, I'm just sorting the thing. It's one of us, but Arlo would like to go first, if people don't mind.
Just to make sure, are they supposed to have 2 initiative slots?
Oh, no, they're not. So
which one is the one that counts?
It's we'll do the first one.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I think it's 4 of us that go first.
But I get one more of these back instead of because I wouldn't have.
Yeah.
Two. Yeah.
I think it's 3 of us first.
There we go. Okay. So there we go. Alright, could Arlo go first then? If people don't mind?
Sure.
Let's
try not to kill them. Let's just render them unconscious and then leave them out, like, just leave them outside the forest.
Arlo is the perfect person to go first.
Yes.
Because he's, him and the Sparrow are the only ones that are doing directly non-lethal damage. So Arlo, would you say that he started, cause he was like up in the tree, could he have been like right above them basically? Okay, so can I take one maneuver to drop down, basically, mm-hmm. right in front of them, and now they have to make a hard fear check.
Okay.
Because Arlo is snarling with anger. Ah, oh, man. Okay. And he is going to take out his Tears of the Sky Queen and wail away on them. Well, I assume he already had them out, really.
Sure.
He was in the tree.
Yep.
That's fine. So, he will take some strain to...
Yeah, let me double check the percents real quick. Defense 1, that's all.
Okay. Just make sure here. Okay. Bam. Okay. One of those is advantage, the other 2 are successes.
Okay.
So he hits twice for 11 damage.
Alright, 11 damage. One second. I'm doing the over on purpose just so I've got a record of it to put onto
some quick math.
And that, but then we've got the second attack now. Oh, actually, with minions, soak only applies once, so let me go back on this. So, 2, And then you said, how much was it? 11? Or how much damage was it?
It was 11 twice.
11 twice, okay. So. Oh, yeah, they're all three of them are knocked out. Describe what happens. If you're talking, Dan, we can't hear you.
Sorry, I was muted. So basically, he drops out of the trees, and in the process, basically just smashes two of them in the top of the head. And then the last one, he just uppercuts and knocks him out.
Okay. Well, with that, you can actually hear some shouts and cries, and no, and you can hear, traitors, fleeing from your post, and you hear screams, and also word, like the sound of whirring blades, and you're like, what is that?
And like mechanical sounding almost?
Yeah, mechanical sounding almost. So it's like, what is that?
And that's terrifying.
You can see trees starting to fall in the distance. And one second here.
Do they have a chainsaw somehow? And there's two Asperums.
Yeah, that's on purpose. One second.
Okay.
Whoops. My bad, guys. Looks like we got a goblin tree cutter. For more crap. Oh no. It's Scrap Heap King all over again.
I know, right? So you have saw golems. These golems have saws on their hands, and they're just slicing through the trees. And remember, as golems, the illusions don't really affect them. So they're just like slicing through, slice. And they see you in the distance. What do you do? And actually, Mavellion is screaming, no! Foul creatures!
Now, these things gotta go.
Okay, so they're cutting down a bunch of the trees. They see us, you said?
Yeah. They're not affected by the illusion, so.
That's true. Here's an odd question. Would the sap of the witchwood trees they cut down count as blood for the blood mist spell Trina knows?
Sure.
Yeah, like once she sees that, she would try to spin the sap into the same kind of mist she's done before. To see if, you know, if they can't be fooled by the illusion, she'll just create something that is actually physical.
Okay, sure.
All right, no, it's lore. What was the? Do we have a set difficulty for that, or?
I'll say it's hard, and I'll say it's hard, but with two setbacks, just because it is a different. It's like a different aspect of the same spell.
Oh, she already has a setback because she didn't learn the spell perfectly. I'm going to flip.
Okay. You'll get a boost from the value.
Sweet. Ah. Darn.
You don't get to roll your force rating with it?
I don't remember. It's the last time we did it was in the fighting pits. I can't remember if I got to add it or not.
I don't think so. If you did, sorry. But I don't think so.
Quick, summon up the recording. I'm fine with this. But let's say maybe instead of an actual okay, how about this? Instead of pulling the blood up and blowing the sap up and forming a mist, I don't disperse it, but I splash it on the golems. Maybe okay.
Like in their eyes?
Yeah, I'm thinking if you'll allow me to kind of maybe temporarily blind them.
I don't think that you would be able to blind. I mean, because they're golems, but I would say that the sap is really sticky, so maybe you could gum up the works on their saws so their saws aren't as effective.
Sure, I go with that.
Okay, so I'll say that with the triumph, we can say triumph and advantage. How about this? They have an upgrade and a setback to their attacks.
I dig it.
Okay.
Sounds good.
All right, let's do initiative.
I mean, you're not just carrying over the same initiative?
Well, no, because, I mean, you guys just saw them, and they just saw you, so.
It's okay.
So I assume we don't get the ambush bonus.
No.
And this should be vigilance then, right?
Yeah. We didn't expect this, guys. Which is good, because Arlo's vigilance is better.
1.3.
Aww.
All right, here they go.
Yikes. Maybe Sophia could try to coerce them into going away.
And they look very similar in terms of stature with the Sparrow. So, yeah.
Mass-produced model.
It's like brothers, except that they've got saws for hands.
My brother has that, doesn't yours? okay. This should look very different from the last one. Okay, so it's an NPC first.
Okay, NPC first. So they're gonna rush at you, Arlo. You're within short distance. Close the distance.
He has to make a fear check.
And fear check. Okay, here goes. Hard fear check.
Yep. I'm gonna. Okay, or not.
Oh,
I was gonna flip for him, but that's fine.
Oh, well, you know what? Let me take mine back, because I didn't even roll the actual, so...
Fair enough. Out,
so, okay. Not afraid, and what are your defenses?
I believe Arlo has no defenses. Yep. Right. He's just...
But they do have a setback and an upgrade to their difficulty from the sap.
That's true.
Right.
And I will also flip in defense, I believe.
Ooh, missed. Zzzz. Describe what happens as this like spinning blade is coming for you.
So he goes to sweep at my legs with the saw, and I just jump over it. Okay. And
And
for that advantage, that's his advantage. Never mind. Yeah. So
you're going to pass Bruce to the next one. Who's up next?
If I could, maybe.
Yeah. Go for it.
All right. What distance are these fellows? Medium. Okay. Well, seeing these golems that are, you know, like, as you said, mass produced, cheap knockoffs, really. So not too impressed or pleased by seeing these. So gonna get up there and do some damage.
All right. Adversary 1, defense 1.
Okay.
Actually, just to make things interesting, what is your soak on this barrel?
6.
Okay.
That's a lot of soak for these early level characters.
Yep.
I will go for a frenzied attack. Try to increase my chances of a crit.
Okay.
There you go.
Alright.
It works.
So go ahead and roll for it. They do have durable one, though.
Okay, so that'll be 10 damage, but let's see, do I have... I have 2 for lethal blows. Oops. Oh, well.
So 13.
Yes.
After a Sparrow attacks, Arlo will just ask real quick, like, Sparrow, is there anywhere we should aim for in particular? You know, these, they seem to be built much like you. Is there a core or something that we can disable?
Go for the leg benders.
I'll tell you what, hold that thought for a second, but let's do the crit. What kind of crit is it?
That 13. Is, 13 is it? So that would be sudden jolt. Target drops whatever's in hand. I doubt it's holding the saws.
Yeah, it's not holding the saws. So.
Yeah. But has a crit, so yeah. It's something.
Perhaps just a setback for a turn.
Sure, I'll do that. One crit, and remind me of the setback.
Okay.
Okay. Next up. Oh wait, you guys had an idea. Sorry, what's going on now?
I guess to answer the question, I would say as you see me attack, you know, taking the swing at it, and I kind of go for it. It's
Well, you know what? Actually, the joint of it. Yeah, this would be something where I'll give it to you as an incidental, but it's kind of like how much do you know yourself? And golems don't really know that much about themselves except for Shard, who's done a lot of study on just everything. So I would say that it would be a knowledge education or xenology check. I'm going to say it's a hard check, but if you pass, you will give everyone a bonus for the entire combat.
Would he get a boost or something because it is himself? Or no?
Sure, get one boost. I will upgrade that check, though.
Nope.
Closer than it could have been, though.
Yeah.
Very true. But you do see me take a swing at the like joints of it and kind of set it, give it, a, you know, that kind of describes the setback of for its next move.
Mm-hmm. All right, another NPC.
NPC, okay.
Two of them, actually.
Two of them, okay. So this one is going to go right... it's going to step on these bodies. And this will be the one that gets a boost.
Hard fear check.
Hard fear check, okay. So...
And I'm going to... never mind. No, I'll let it stand.
Okay, so... What do you want to do with those three threats?
Strain? Could I make an immediate free maneuver and back out of his engage range?
Okay, yeah. So, I'll take another maneuver and we'll take two strain for that. And with that triumph, I'm going to say he gets an upgrade on his attack. Because he's really,
Instead of moving, actually, defensive stance, rather, instead, for my maneuver.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
So he's not going to take the strain.
So he doesn't have to take the strain, then. Yeah.
Got it. Okay. Defensive maneuver. So, refresh my memory, that's another upgrade?
That gives him a setback.
Setback, okay. And he has a native upgrade from the Tetrina's sap maneuver. And another setback, yep.
Yep, and I will flip in defense.
He's got one boost... He's got an upgrade, and he flipped in defense. Okay, so it's two reds. Here goes. Zzzz. Whoa! A miss! Wow, ooh, you guys are getting lucky. Okay, so that one misses and nothing else. And then the next one is going to go for a Sparrow. And...
I have just one defense.
Alright, and it's just going to say... malfunctioning golem... Destroy, terminate, destroy. Refuses the command of the masters. So, one defense, you said, right?
Yes.
All right, I'm going to flip. And I think that's it. Okay. And you flipped, right? Or no?
No, I did not flip.
All right. All right, so it is going to take two strain for those threats. And why didn't that work? But it is going to hit you for 9 pierce 2. Okay. And a crit.
Oof. And I have 3 crits already, so.
Oh, jeez.
Yikes.
Alright, you roll for it.
Wait, 3? It said 1 crit on there, didn't it?
No.
The spare has 3 crits.
Oh, 3. I thought it said 1.
It has one crit is on one of the salt golems.
Yeah, that's what it was, yeah. They all look the same.
Wow.
So, which one is which?
So that's plus 30 then?
Yes.
Okay, 51 is Fearsome Wound. The difficulty of all your presence and willpower checks are increased until the end of the encounter.
Not my
that
presence
is so very, so very debilitating on you. It's an average crit.
Okay, woo-hoo. More all average right. crits.
Next up.
Next up is a PC, and I'll have Jatrina take it. She will take a maneuver and go over to Sophia's sword, and she'll actually repeat the motion she did back in Haven and trace her finger around the circle of the Sky Queen sigil. And after that, the sigil will begin to glow, reducing its crit rating by one.
Okay, cool.
Yep. And that commits a force die, and I actually still have my action, but I'm not going to be able to do much.
Oh, I forgot. My force rating is one higher now. I didn't use it on the last roll.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. That's important.
You can throw in an extra one for the next one to even it out.
Oh, I mean, I would have murdered all three of them last time anyway.
Oh, right, yeah.
Well, yeah. Murdered, quote-unquote. They're not actually dead. They're unconscious. Yeah. But, okay.
I'll just have, at least narratively, Trishina take a defensive posture next to Mavelian, but that'll be it for me.
Okay.
Sophia would like to go next. So she already has her shield, Durandal and her shield out. So she's going to rush to aid a Sparrow. She's going to take two strain to do that.
Adversary 1, defense 1.
Cool. I'm also going to commit a force die for defense and a force die for attack.
Okay.
So that. So adversary 1, defense 1. And let me just see. Make sure I have that right. Melee, where are you? Yep. Okay. So, stabby. Aw.
Nope.
A miss. We'll say I pass a boost to the next how many is it to add a setback? Is it two advantages?
It's two. Yeah.
Two? So I'll put a setback on the one that was crit. On the one that wasn't crit.
Okay.
Well, I think it has to be the one you attacked.
Yeah, that.
Yeah, yeah. So it would be that one. It'll put two setbacks on it, so because it has.
All right, yeah. Two. So yeah, I'll put a setback on it.
Okay.
Arlo can take the next slot.
All right.
So he is already in the face of this guy. So he is going to. It was defense 1, right?
Adversary 1, defense 1.
Oh, adversary 1 as well. Okay. And he will take two strain to double aim. And here we go. Oh! I'm not sure what that despair is gonna do, but.
You run out of ammo.
My fists! I have to reload. But I will use that that light side as an advantage to hit twice.
Okay. How much damage is it?
Yeah. So that would be.
And what type of damage is it?
Blunt force trauma, strain damage.
Okay.
He has no reason to hit specifically for wounds at the moment. These could potentially be salvaged and used for our benefit later. So that'll be 7 damage. Oh, we never know. We could either convince them or somehow reprogram them if that's a thing.
So
we can
how much
do.
Was it again? Sorry.
7 twice.
7 twice. Unfortunately, none of it gets through.
Oh man.
And one thing that you notice, blunt force trauma does not work very well on them. You might say that they seemed very resolved.
Hmm. So that's Arlo's turn.
Yeah, it's like, I mean, you're hitting metal with your fists, and you don't hurt yourself, but it's like clunk clunk.
Okay.
All right, next up. Who's up next?
Everyone's gone. I think
NPC. Right at the top.
Oh, top of the round. Okay. So the one that you just went clunk clunk on is going to go right back for you. And upgrading the check.
Are you in defense? I defense flipped. Yeah.
Okay. Defense flipped. So two reds. It is going to aim. Here goes. Wow!
Can its saw just break or maybe be damaged?
Yeah, sure. We'll say
if
that.
Maybe it swipes at me and I just like hit the side of the saw and mess up the mechanism.
Yeah, I like it. Okay, you've broken the saw, so now it just has to use its bare hands. Bare stump. So.
Yeah.
Okay, yep. That is definitely less damage and no pierce, so good job. Let me actually change the name on that, so.
Stump Golem.
It's Stumpy. Okay.
Stumpy.
And, but all those advantages, I'm going to say that it's going to pass an advantage and a boost. Well, it's going to pass two boosts to the very next one. And then the other advantages, I'll say, it will... not really much to do. That's fine. So two boosts to the next one. All right, next up.
I guess I'll follow up and try to go at this fella again.
Okay.
Go for it.
I'll go for friendly attack again.
Do you say anything to these golems? Like, they're like, malfunctioning golem. Resisting the masters. Destroy, destroy.
I mean, they do seem... You don't seem well. I will try to repair you.
With force if necessary.
Yes.
That'll be a 10 again. And I will recover a strain.
Sorry, what was... How much was
it? 10.
10, okay. Bonk. Alright, next up.
Two NPCs.
Oh, can I try the... Well, it was incident last time, so maybe not, but try the knowledge roll again, or...
Well, no, I mean, so you don't know. Alright, so both of these golems are going for you. This one has two setbacks on top of the other setback it's got.
And I have one defense.
One defense. Oh, wow, okay. That's four setbacks total. I'm gonna flip. It's gonna aim.
None are coming after little old me?
Oh.
No, it wants to get the other golem. It's actually going to aim twice because it really is affronted.
I'm going to flip one. So.
Alright. Here goes. Yeah. So, 7 pierce 2.
Okay.
And then the next one is going to go. And actually, I'm going to say the same thing. It's going to be... two less setbacks, though. Are you going to add a setback? Or you do add a setback. Okay. Are you going to...
I have my defense. I just have melee defense 1, and yes, I will also upgrade this one.
Okay. And this one is aiming twice, so I'm gonna put some strain on it. You are an abomination.
Well, isn't that the pot calling the kettle?
All right. So that's going to be 9 pierce 2. It will remove one strain. And with that despair, what do you want to do with this despair?
Would it be possible to cause one of its arms to malfunction?
Sure. I mean, you can break the saw like Arlo did too, if you want.
Describe sure. So like it swings at and I it cuts into like part of me, but I basically with it kind of having closed the gap, I just use like...
Well, why don't we do something different? What if you actually yank this arm off out of the socket?
maybe you like did like two hands catching the blade thing and then just pull it off.
Yeah, it's like cutting into like the shoulder, and I'm essentially close. The distance is close between us. Just basically am able to just kind of reach with both of my arms, and as was suggested, I pulled the arm off.
Okay, cool. So it's got its other arm, but it doesn't have a blade, so. I'm going to put this one as one arm. it's still stuck.
Old one arm.
Okay. I would like
Stumpy,
to
Stumpy, one arm and one crit.
Yep. And I'm going to go after one crit.
Alright.
I'm going to aim, and it is adversary one, defense one, and... Alright, that is much better. So that is going to be... Let me see, I think 6 pierce 2. Yes, 6 pierce 2.
6 pierce 2. Okay, one second here. So 6 pierce 2. Alright.
Okay. And then, so I crit on one advantage. So I can do a crit plus 40. Maybe a crit plus 50 with his thing, with his already crit.
Well, you did the... Let me just make sure you've got... So you already... You used one to activate it. So then you have three more left. So that's plus 30.
So 3 advantages and the triumph.
And the triumph. Oh, got it. And then you also have his crit. Okay, yeah, go for it.
So crit plus 50.
Wow.
Yeah, boy.
Wow. So that is the end is nigh.
Woo!
Wow. Okay.
So I jam it right into its chest, and I must hit its power core or something, because it starts sparking and whirring and, like, just... Ugh.
Totally.
Yeah, it will die at the last initiative slot during the next round.
Okay. Cool.
If it makes it that long.
Next up.
Arlo can go. Seeing how trying to deal strain damage was, trying to do like regular blunt force trauma wasn't working, he's gonna put a little more oomph into this one.
Okay.
Punch it really, really hard.
Yeah, I mean, that's all he can really do differently. Just punch it harder.
You're focusing the force. The Witchwood trees are with you.
He's more likely to use it for straight up damage than.
Or no, maybe instead of like fists so much, you're doing karate chops now. Yeah.
Instead of using his fists, he's using his palms.
Okay.
So there's adversary one, defense one.
And beyond all of that, this is a kick-ass.
And he will aim twice. Take two strain. And that looks good. All of those are going to go into successes.
Not advantages?
No, he's... One success last time was not enough for anything.
Oh, got
it. Two might not.
Got it. Okay. Yeah.
So yeah, they're all going to go into successes.
How much is it?
So that would be... 10 damage.
10 damage, okay, yeah.
Isn't there Pierce on the Tears of the Sky Queen?
Nope. Oh. They're effectively brass knuckles.
Oh, okay.
Alright, next up.
I'm relying on eventually getting enough Seek to add Pierce to my moves.
Not a bad way to go.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't know Seek could do that, that's cool.
Oh yeah, I'm looking forward to it.
It's like Shatterpoint.
Yes. Well, it can also add Triumphs, too.
Ooh, nice, okay.
Yeah, I think that might have been the partial intent.
Yeah. Alright, next up.
Is it just Dravina?
Yep.
Alright. How far away is the group? Just medium. Short?
We're
medium.
Yeah.
Okay. Ooh. Alright, then I guess she'll take 3 strain. She'll see that Asperum is starting to take the blows pretty hard, so she'll actually rush in and begin some emergency repairs with her mental tools.
Okay, describe what you're actually doing here.
She actually, as she starts running towards the Sparum, she drags her hands against probably the very damp soil that's now damp because of the Witchwood sap, and she'll as she puts her hands onto a Sparum, they start to faintly glow and get like really hot, at least from the outside in. Her hands are
like
just
it.
Fine, and she just starts bending the plates back into shape.
Wow, okay, I like
and
it.
Seeing you running up, doing this, he would like just turn his spin his torso, but keep himself like turned forward, like he, you know, like maybe rotating away so that his torso is towards you, so that you might do this.
Oh, I like it. You know what? For both of your RP, I'm gonna give you guys I'll let him actually get an incidental boost to you as a help maneuver, and you get an RP boost with the sap. So two boosts total.
All right, and it's over half, so it would be average.
I would think this would be upgraded because the combat is still happening, right?
I'd go for it.
Yeah, let's upgrade it once.
Oh, I don't want to make that hard. I'm also going to flip to see if I can get a triumph to clear one of these crits. Sweet.
Wow. All
right, so that's only going to repair one hit point, but you will be able to clear a crit. She doesn't, like, a lot of the more damage to your armor kind of remains, but she's able to find one of the parts where they did the most damage and fix it. But you also get 4 strain back.
Oh, yeah, nice. Good one.
Thanks.
All right. Next up.
Okay, top of the round. NPC.
NPC, gosh, the one that's going to die. It turns from Asperum, actually. It was going to go for Asperum, but the fact that you stuck your sword right in it, it's affronted and is going for Sophia. What are your defenses, Sophia?
Which one was
going
to die? Was that one crit?
One crit, yeah.
Yeah, it's one crit. So I have 2 upgrades from Sense. I have 2 defense, and I'm going to spend a destiny point to use Baleful Gaze, because I'm being targeted by a combat check by someone in medium range or less.
Okay.
And add my ranks in coercion as upgrades to the check, so it's going to add 2 more upgrades. So I'm effectively adversary 4, defense 2.
Okay, wow. All right. It already has 1 upgrade from just sap, and we're saying how many upgrades? 4 upgrades total?
4 upgrades.
4 upgrades on top of the other one, so 5 upgrades.
Yep.
Wow, 5 upgrades. Okay, 4. So 1.
And 2 defense.
5, so it's going to be 4 reds.
Yep.
How many setbacks, or how much defense do you have?
2 setbacks.
All right, so it'll be 3 total.
2 defense.
And it's going to aim with everything it's got, so it's going to take strain to do it. I'm not even going to mark it because it's going to be dead anyway, so 2 boosts. I did upgrade the check, so okay. Here goes.
Does it still succeed that?
That's crazy.
Yeah, so that's 6 pierce 2.
Okay. So 5, so I soak 3 of it, so I take 3. And for the despair, this one's going to lose its saw blade too.
Well, it's going to die anyway, so you can do something else with the despair.
So I have an idea. Since it's going to die, can Sophia deflect, like, so she gets hit, but can she pop the shield, like, use her shield to pop the arm into one arm to remove its other arm?
I mean, I guess what I'm saying is that I'll let you use the despair to do something else.
Oh, no, she's saying she wants it to hit the other golem.
So, like...
Oh, yeah, yeah, okay, that's actually what I was thinking of, too, so,
yeah.
Okay.
So it sort of falls over and cuts off the arm of one arm. That's right.
Well, I'm not going
to
say it's going to cut off both arms. I'm going to say that, because that's a lot for despair on something that's not one arm. But I'll say that you can have it attack, so it'll also do the same damage to one arm.
Sure, that works.
So 6 pierce 2. All right. Next up.
One player.
Unless you could go ahead, but I was just gonna continue this assault.
One arm is effectively down. Arlo will take on Stumpy real quick. You can continue your assault after they go, I guess. Or unless you want to go first, actually.
Well, I'm thinking I might want to, because if one arm gets a good hit on me, I'm probably gonna go down. So maybe if I can at least do.
Yeah, well, maybe you can.
Move.
Maybe you can hit them and then back out of there. Yeah.
True. Very true.
Go for that.
Okay. So yeah, I'm gonna same as before, and I will. I think I'll flip this time. What about you, Tommy?
Yes.
Okay.
Oops.
And I will aim. This time. All right.
That's a really good hit.
So that is 10 again. A lot of 10s. And I will, let's see, I have 3 advantages. Oh, I'll crit with those 3 advantages, so I'll crit at 20.
Okay.
So you'll keep the triumph for something, or?
Well, I'm not sure what I could. No, I was thinking I would just, you know, crit plus 20 with with advantages in the triumph, but I'm not really sure what I could do to. Perhaps I could inflict some kind of a increased difficulty on its next attack. Is that a thing you can do with a triumph?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Pass an upgrade to someone else.
Well, it's gonna go next. Probably gonna go for me. I think I'm gonna inflict a penalty on it.
Okay. Did you still want to have a crit plus something?
It'll be a crit plus 20 because I have 2 for lethal blows. But yeah, that's what I use the 3 advantages for. So
a crit plus 10 because it's got durable one.
Right. 57.
Okay, 57 is Agonizing Wound. Increases the difficulty of all brawn and agility checks by 1.
Oh, that's a perfect one for it.
So it's not only is it upgraded, but it's also increased.
Yeah,
and okay. I will just disengage from it.
Okay, cool. Actually, describe how you do that, though.
Well, I think, you know, it's been... it got swung at by 1 crit, and so that kind of like knocked it in a way that allowed me to just swing like a really good shot on its arm. All and right. That's
any,
kind of
any choice yeah. words for your wayward brethren?
Let's see. You are in a state of disrepair as well. I will fix you as well.
Okay.
Fix in giant air quotes.
Right. And I'll also just disengage.
Okay, cool. Next up.
Two NPCs.
Two NPCs, okay. I guess it's Stumpy and One Arm then, yeah?
Yeah.
Alright, so One Arm is going to re-engage. Will aim once, and so more...
One defense.
One defense, okay. Upgraded attack. So it's already 2 reds, 2 setbacks. I'm going to flip. Anything else?
I will flip as well.
All right. Oh, and it already has the increased difficulty, so it's going
from
to be 3 reds.
The crit, yeah.
All right, here goes. Ooh.
Oh, okay.
It only has 1 arm, though, so it's only 7, no pierce. And it'll take a strain.
Oh, okay. Well, then I guess I don't go down this time.
Really close, though, it looks like.
Yeah. Yeah. And the other one is going to go for Arlo. And I'll do the same thing. It's going to aim twice, though. It really wants to hit you.
Arlo is flipping in defense.
All right, so mechanically, what are you doing?
Giving them an upgrade.
Okay. Got it. All right. So it's only 2 reds and any defenses? Sorry. Any defense?
Sure, no.
Alright. So aiming twice. Critted, boom. Oh. So it is going to crit you. And that's gonna be 9 pierce 2. No. 7 no pierce because it's Stumpy.
That's true. Yeah.
But it does crit you still though.
Okay. Man, I don't have heroic fortitude, I can't just ignore it. 7, right?
7, yep.
Oh man, if only I had 1 more brawn, I could have soaked all of that.
Well, there are plenty of droids around, you can probably cut off your arm and then replace it with a droid arm.
Golem.
No, I'm okay.
Or golem. Yes, golem limbs. Golem arms.
Arlo gets a lot of use out of his arms, he's used to those, he doesn't want new ones.
Well, I might look to get some new golems. We'll see.
Cannibalizing your fallen brothers. Nice.
Oh, just waiting for your crit.
Oh, I figured you'd roll it.
No. I let you guys roll all crits.
Yeah. Okay. 23 is off balance. I get a setback on my next check.
All
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Next up.
It's all PCs, right?
I think so.
Yep. Can Arlo retaliate?
Go for it.
Go for it.
Okay, let me just break down my crit here. Okay, so going to aim twice, two stern for that. Oh wait, did I? I never took the strain from last time, did I? So that should actually be. He will not aim, because he's getting up there in strain now. But.
You still got plenty.
Yeah. Yeah, he'll go for the 1-2 punch again, I guess.
I'll upgrade the check. Never mind.
Ooh.
Take those three threats of strain.
Well, so here's the thing. I could put...
Oh, you can use those to get, make advantages, yeah.
I can, yeah. Okay. I'm using all of these. So that all those advantages. Mm-hmm. So I'll be able to hit twice. Ooh. For 11 damage.
11 twice, nice. That was quite a hit. I assume lethal damage.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Nice.
Well done.
So I have a question, Tommy. So what is the distance between Sophia and one arm crit one?
Short,
okay. So Sophia is going to sort of duck under Asperum's arm, positioning her shield above her head, and she's going to move into engaged with one arm crit one, and... Okay. Taking Durandal, stabbing him upwards into its chest.
All right.
I'm going to take two strain to aim.
Okay.
So there's boop, boop, boop. And, all right.
Nice.
That's going to be 7 pierce 2.
Right, 7 pierce 2.
Then I can trigger a crit with 1, and then add 10 for each other advantage. So it'll be a crit plus 20... Plus 30 because of its other crit.
Okay. And so, minus 10, just remember that.
Yeah, so crit plus 20, so 89.
Oh, that might be overpowered.
It's okay. Definitely close. It is compromised. increased difficulty of all skill checks by 1.
Oh gosh, it already has an increased difficulty. Wow! 2 crits, wow!
Very nice.
So we'll say Sophia's sword's able to find its way kind of into its, like, the connecting area where its arm connects to the torso and kind of work Durandal in there a little bit before retracting the blade and taking a defensive position in front of a sparrow.
Mess up some servos in there.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Cool. Good move. Next up.
I think it's just a Trina.
Might as well get some use out of Veil Render. I mean, I know it's kind of hard to wield at the moment, but I mean, one arm is kind of... Oh no, Stumpy's really close. You're short range from Stumpy.
Yeah. And your teacher is right there.
Arm and Stumpy.
I don't want to show that my teacher just how bad I am.
Actually, we can say, stab it!
I think he's already seen.
So you'll get a boost from the Valiant shouting you on. You know, use Veil Render.
Do I? Since he hasn't had really a chance to train me, I assume I still take all the malices.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. I'll take a maneuver to get engaged. Quick draw, Veil Render, stabby, stabby.
I won't flip or anything, so you.
All right.
Going for one arm or Stumpy?
Let's see. It's upgraded once, and has a difficulty, and it's just gonna be too green because I haven't been able to switch the base skill yet.
You have a light side.
Yeah, sure. I'll flip. I think I'm just wasting it, though. Yeah.
Aww. Well, you got a triumph. That wouldn't have happened otherwise.
Maybe you don't. It actually blocks the Witchwood Sword, but you open it up. You open. You give an opening to the next person.
So yeah, I'll pass an upgrade to whoever attacks Stepping next.
And a boost.
So that would be Arlo, definitely.
Yeah. Still did something good. Mavellion's still... You gotta try if he's still impressed. He's, you know, your form needs work. He actually yells at, your form needs work!
Well, that's why I have you.
And now, old one crit falls dead.
Yes. And top of the round, right?
Yep.
Alright, so one crit is down, and Stumpy is going to go for Arlo again. And
flipping defensively.
Yeah.
Oh, wait, actually, you have to flip first. This is only one left here. Because I can't flip the same token. But yeah.
Okay. So, actually, it's using its stump. It's going to go for strain. So, it is aiming twice.
And Arlo, I already flipped defensively, yeah. So.
Alright, so you upgraded, and... And it already has an upgrade, so it's two upgrades and a setback, because of the sound. Okay, here goes. Ooh.
Really?
That is seven strain.
But I soak six of it, so it's
nice.
Only one.
Woo! Clunk.
He kind of, he hits me in like the arm, and I'm like, ah, I kind of stung a little, and that's really it.
Alright, cool. Next up.
That's a PC, and can I finish off Stumpy?
There's no more. Go for it.
You've got that.
You've got an upgrade and a boost.
So.
Yeah.
Or, Katrina can go next and take that upgrade and boost, and hopefully finish off Stumpy.
But let's not.
I don't think Katrina needs pity. Just from herself.
Just do it.
At this point.
She'll take enough pride that she didn't cut herself.
He has
which
no need
can
to
happen on this.
Fists here, so he's just going to go for one.
I will upgrade the check.
Okay, so it's two reds then. And it's like one maneuver to aim. Bam. Yeah. It's down. That's 11 damage again. Or actually, let's go 13, actually. Why not? Use those two light sides for damage. Or actually, no, I don't need to. They're all advantages. So I have 5 advantage.
So heal strain.
Yeah, I'm gonna get 5 strain back, actually, because I need it back. So I basically backhand him in the chest and he falls over, and I take like a deep breath and just kind of like a little meditative thing and calm myself down a little.
Okay. Next up.
I think it's an end. I think it's one arm.
Right, one yep. arm. Gosh, 4 base difficulty.
Without any like.
Well, no, it's only 2 base difficulty. I have to flip. To make it 4.
Well, no, it's got those crits that increase.
It's 2.
Oh, yeah, it does. So now it's 6 and 2 defense.
Well, no. Oh. You don't increase the difficulty, you upgrade, correct?
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, okay. I upgrade.
So how many upgrades total?
5 if you flip, right?
2 from Sense, and no, 2 from Baleful Gaze.
So 4.
Right. Okay. But if I thought one of. I thought it was one upgrade and then the
it's
crit
got its own. I just want to know just from you.
Okay, yeah. So 4 upgrades from me and 2 setbacks.
Got it. Okay. So here goes.
He's trying really hard to land this punch.
I need to make sure I do this right. So yes. All right. Here goes. And it misses. Okay.
All right.
Surprisingly close, actually.
Yeah. A lot closer than it should have been. So Sophia will, like, bat the arm, its arm away with her shield. Mm-hmm. And then she will stick it like a pig. Big golem-y pig. So she's going to... Oh, why not? She'll take 2 strain to aim. 2 strain to aim twice. So that's 1, 1, and 1. All right, so that's going to be 10 Pierce 2.
10 Pierce 2. This might do it. So 10 Pierce 2. Ooh. Got it.
Excellent. So she stabs it right in the same spot as she stabbed one crit. sort of like right in the center of its chest.
All right. So, good job, guys. However, you can hear sounds of battle all over the place. There are more saws, and Tatrina, you feel a massive wave of magic. And
he's here.
Yeah, you can smell smoke. And as you turn to try to go to Haven, your way is blocked off. One second. And Mavalian's like, no, no! So we're going to need some survival checks.
Oh, no.
I'm
really good at survival, so.
Are these party-wide checks or individual?
Individual, because the flames, there is wind moving through the trees that is pushing the fire. Like, you guys are pretty much surrounded. I mean, it is very rapid, very fast. And you guys need to run, and you're trying to find your way. So actually, it can be survival or coordination. So you are just trying to get away from these flames.
Could Arlo use resilience and just kind of power his way through?
Yes.
Okay.
But actually, I'm going to upgrade the check for everybody. Okay, so it is hard upgraded once. Resilience, coordination, survival. Yeah. Or athletics, actually. Okay. You can use athletics. To, like, jump over stuff.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I had to look away for a sec. Was it hard?
Yes.
Hard with one upgrade.
Okay.
Yeah, so Arlo's using that, like,
matches my dice pool.
So I cancel out the threat there. But he succeeded.
Okay.
Can I use those advantages to assist him? Like, give him a boost?
Unfortunately, no. They're just going to have to be for you.
Okay.
Okay. Could Sophia possibly get a boost if she's powering through behind Arlo, but using her shield to kind of, like, I don't know.
Or just a boost from using your shield.
Yeah, just a boost from using your shield, sure.
Okay. Then I will flip my resilience. Come on! Oh my!
Better than it could have been.
Yeah, take all those threats to strain.
Yeah. Can I use the triumph to grab Tatrina by the collar and drag her through as well?
Well, hold on to that thought. Okay. I'll say that yes, you can. Yeah, you can drag her through, but some stuff is going to happen because of that failure and a threat. Also, to Tatrina, take a strain for that threat that you had. And did Asperum go? Yeah. Did everyone?
Yes, roll? I had three advantages.
Okay, so Tatrina. You are on fire. You are burning. So you have burn 2 right now, and that's 6 damage right now. So we need to get you not on fire.
Through soak or ignoring soak?
Ignoring soak. Like, I mean, it's just you're burning.
Well, can I perhaps say that my hands still have, like, the sap and soil mixture? Could I, like, try rubbing that on the burns?
Sure.
Or at least the burning areas.
I'll give you a boost, and then someone else can give you an assistance maneuver. So to get rid of burns, I believe that it's a coordination roll, right, guys? It's in the core rulebook to get rid of fire, like the stop, drop, and roll maneuver.
It comes up so rarely, I'm not really sure.
I know, right? That's why I was like, I've got to do this. I'll look it up. It's under the burn quality. Yeah, so while I'm looking it up, give me some RP. I mean, this is Mavellian screaming. Like, this fire has blocked off Haven. And Yoko's freaking out. And, this is like, the worst nightmare to see Witchwood trees on fire.
So Arlo's basically leading the way, and he's finding the spots where the fire is the thinnest or the farthest away from, but still in the direction he has to go. And he's just kind of forging a path ahead.
I'm actually going to say this. Mavellian, he is so struck by all this, he's not moving.
Oh, well, then I guess Katrina's just going to keep burning because she's going to try and drag him off. It's like, I didn't bring you all this way just to see you die here.
Sophia's going to yell at him, to try to snap out of it, to try to
force
him
to
snap out of it.
Before Katrina runs over, we can definitely try that. So, okay. Yeah. It will be, I'll say it's a hard coercion check, or leadership.
This is going to be coercion. Sophia's going to look back.
I'll upgrade it.
Okay. And shout at him, you need to move or you're going to die. No. Just move your ass. That's what she's going to yell at him. Move your ass. And she's going to whistle at Yoko to come back to her. So I'll flip because I want him to actually move his ass. Son of a gun.
Would you perhaps get a boost from Trichina trying to get him off too?
Sure. Yeah.
Alright. I'll throw a boost at it. Hey, alright!
Okay, he snaps out of it. Yoko's also, like, grabbing at his pants leg, like, go, go, go! So he runs over. To Trina, guess what? You're on soft ground. It is an easy coordination check.
That is only going to do me so good because coordination is terrible for me. I'm going to flip because Lord help me.
You can get a boost from Sophia. She'll use her shield to try to help. Well, not her shield, but her
cloak. Pound the shield on her.
Help smother you. Yeah.
Bam, bam, bam. Is the fire out yet? Bam, bam.
Fires away.
Maybe just your cloak, Sophia.
Yeah, just the cloak. Yeah. The cloak.
All right. Cool. Yeah. You stop yourself from burning, and okay, so you're blocked off from Haven, but you are racing through the trees, and yeah, it's a terrible sight. And you can hear screams of little folk off in the distance, and more whirring, and saws, and fire, and it's all terrible. And before long, as you all race forward, you get to the tree line, and you turn around, and you see this. Quite a fire. And in the flames, you almost see a face take shape of the Primarch. He is coming for you. But you now see, as you turn from the flames, you see a vast, like, wasteland. There is some plant life, but everything. You know what, actually? Give me. An average education check. Okay. It looks like there was. Oh, it was just one for the party, but.
Oh. Oh, I'm sorry.
Surrounding the Blood Spire, Sweet Spire, it looks like there are. You see petrified trees. And blast marks, or almost looks like blast marks, pushing everything outwards, all the way to the line of trees, of the Witchwood trees.
So it looks like it fell in place there? Almost?
Well, no, it looks like an explosion that knocked everything outward, but stopped at the Witchwood trees.
Hmm.
But yeah, it's you do see some plant life, but it's this really rocky scrubland wasteland from here all the way to the Queen's Fire.
While we're still in, like, an area before it becomes the wasteland, uh-huh. We maybe try to gather some materials for healing salves of some kind?
Yeah. I'm going to say it's two setbacks, because you have to move fast. Oh, you know what? Actually, no. You guys can just take two each, actually, just from being in Haven. They would have given them two.
Oh, okay.
So, yeah, you've got two. You kind of can't really tarry too long, because the fire is overtaking you, or will overtake you. So, at that, you see Mavelian, and he passes out from just all of this. So, he's out unconscious. You guys are traveling through this wasteland. Who goes to sleep first?
Arlo is keeping watch. And anyone else who wants to can. Esperum doesn't really sleep. I don't know if he wanted to.
Sophia is fairly winded. She will feel she's going to try to rest after finding, I don't know, something she can use to prop her head.
Okay. So, everyone who's asleep, put your tokens by Mavelian. Okay, so. Sophia, you get this vision. It looks like Mavelian has actually pulled you into a dream. So, let's see. Hmm. So he is walking side by side with you, and off in the distance you see a massive army. And at the head, you see, you know this is King Rost. And, oh, I see someone chatted. What's this?
I'll take the 51% on the left, you take the 49% on the right.
So you see King Rost.
Arlo will go for the head.
That's what Sophia says to him when they first come upon.
Mavellion starts shaking his head, and as he points to the king, you can see another shape superimposed on him. He is possessed. He is one of the fallen. And as soon as Mavellion points that out, you see the head turn to you, and then the vision ends. And we come to the end of Shadows of the Veil 14, Memory and Dream. All right. I know it's not that big of a surprise, but not the Primarch, actually. So.
Fair enough.
All right, so.
God, I hate Xfinity.
You hate what?
His ISP.
Ah, Xfinity, okay. I was like, what did he say? So, XP-wise, it is 10 base XP. And you get plus 1 XP for turning... Oh, actually, no, I'm going to give you plus 2 XP for sparing that one group and getting them to turn away. That's partly also the whole ruse of being the Sky Queen, so plus 2 for all that. I'll give you plus 1 for defeating the Sawbots.
Do we get anything for the successful Seek there?
Yes! Oh, yeah, yeah. Plus 1 for that. So we're now at 14 XP. Great RP. I'm going to bump that up to 15, just overall. And I think I'm going to lock it there. And, yeah, so let's talk about Merp and MVP. So, most interesting role player.
I mean, Tatrina had a lot of time to shine, as did Sophia had a bunch too.
Okay. Any other nominations? I mean, I'm gonna nominate Tatrina. There was lots of RP from Tatrina as well. So, all right. So, put your votes in for Tatrina and Sophia.
Yeah, I wouldn't say that it was a reason to nominate myself, but I was quite happy with the repair.
Oh yeah, yeah, that was a good one.
Can do a lot of stuff with the Witchwood stuff.
Yeah. All right. So, Tatrina, most interesting role player. Congrats. Let's go to MVP. So, most valuable player. And as before, I'm also going to put in a nomination. I nominate Sophia for just, that was pretty big.
Stonewalling those Sawbots as well.
Oh, nice, with Sarasu, cool. All right, so we've got Arlo and Sophia. Put in your votes for MVP. All right, Arlo gets it. So congratulations, Arlo, on MVP. Now, let's talk about morality. Or damnation
versus grace.
We all
got... one or two for the ambush.
Yeah, I'm going to say that with the ambush, I mean, these guys were so hapless and helpless, so I'd say two conflict for that.
But we did go out of our way to not kill them.
That's true.
That is true. We did not kill them.
One conflict.
Okay. Can we see our tokens potentially?
Oh yeah.
Those of us behind the horse. So that's 6 total. And for me,
for Chatrina, I'm tacking on the 1 for the ambush, and I'm also adding 2 more conflict just because she's has something boiling inside her after seeing Haven destroyed. Since there was, especially now that she can't access the Blood Spire, Queen Spire, all those lovely names for it. Mm-hmm. So,
but we can, aren't? Can't we see it off in the distance?
Yeah, you're on your way. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I thought Haven was, like, around the Bloodspire.
No. So it's a line of trees, and beyond the forest is a vast wasteland on the way to the Queenspire.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's not a ring around. I mean, this is a massive mountain, so...
All right. Then Haven just having a treasure trove of knowledge that she doesn't have access to anymore because they burned it for stupid reasons and because their leader's possessed.
Yep.
She's mad.
Sparum doesn't get conflict, but it does feel a bit bad about having to fight, you know, fellow droids and dismantle them, so.
Definitely.
3 imaginary conflict points, we'll say.
Yeah.
If he were to get conflict, that's what it would be.
Oh, so Chatrina goes up 8, actually. Wow.
Yep, she's back a bit closer to the balance point. Yeah. Not in immediate danger of falling to damnation.
Cool.
Yeah. Arlo stays deadlocked at his previous value.
Same with Sophia. She's still topped out at 100.
Although he's not topped out, he just rolled the exact same amount as his conflict.
Yeah.
All right, with that, I will call it here. Thank you guys for playing, and join us next time in 2 weeks for Shadows of the Veil 15. And I thought I had the title for it, but I don't have it in front of me right now, so... Stay tuned, but I'll try to get the announcement up a little bit earlier than this time around. See you guys.
Working title Blue Harvest.